If the first album you ever bought was Blondie's Parallel Lines, this next story is going to make you feel really old. It's now 40 years since the group formed, and Blondie is still a genre-defying musical force, easily blending disco, punk, pop, new wave, and even rap. They're about to release their 11th studio album, Pollinator, and they're on the road in Australia with another musical legend, Sydney Lauper. Monique Shafter caught up with Blondie's Debbie Harry and Chris Stein.
Debbie, over the years, you've been asked hundreds of times what it feels like to be a sex symbol. How do you feel about that question? Does it piss you off?
Wait, I have to put my shades on. Oh, yeah, okay, now I'm ready. How does it feel?
Yeah.
Feels pretty good. I don't really think about it that much, and, you know, at this point in my life, I think it's terribly flattering. I think it's part and parcel of being in entertainment and, you know, being a lead singer. You know, I think that one has to be sexual and one has to, you know, attract people in that way. It has to be a magnetic thing.
Blondie formed in the 1970s in New York City. Can you describe the elements of that time and place that gave birth to such a unique band?
Well, it, you know, it was dirty and you had to watch your back, and there wasn't anything to compare it to except maybe science fiction movies.
Rents were low, and, you know, it was just a fertile ground, you know, for people like us, you know, who were struggling to, you know, put something together, and it was economically feasible.
Yeah,
and
you didn't have to have a job to focus on the band back then.
Yeah, a bit different these days.
Yeah.
I can't wait to touch you in the flesh.
Australia is actually where you had your first ever hit single back in 1977, and it was thanks to Molly Meldrum stuffing up and playing In the Flesh on Countdown, which was the B-side to your more edgy song, Ex-Offender. That was a happy accident.
Well, in retrospect, I wonder if it was really an accident or Molly having a better view of his audience.
Right.
I asked him, he said he holds on to the story that it was an accident. We saw him in recent years, but...
Oh, he gave me a wink.
Yeah.
So you guys used to be a couple. It's great to see that you're still friends. How hard was it...
I hate him.
Right, clearly. How hard was it to navigate the intensity of a romantic relationship while also being in this ridiculously successful rock band?
Yeah, we had a good balance, and... You know, if I was losing it, you know, he would say, settle down. You know, my sense of whatever insanity or absurdity, you know, was often comforting to Chris. God knows why.
A different kind of trust in a personal relationship, I think.
Yeah.
Than just with the jerks in the band, you know.
Chris.
Chris, you got sick in 1983 with a very serious and rare autoimmune disease, and you both stepped away from the spotlight to deal with that. Was that one of those reality check moments where everything just comes into perspective?
Yeah, to a certain extent. I don't know how much my reality was checked. It led to me not doing so much drugs, because I definitely screwed with my immune system.
Not only was Chris desperately ill and recovering, but, you know, our record company folded. Chrysalis went out of business. So with that, you know, we were sort of left in a big, you know, floating sort of, what do we do now, you know, and it just sort of all melted away.
Songs like Heart of Glass and Call Me are still played in clubs these days. What is it about what's the enduring appeal of your music?
the stuff doesn't really sound dated. It holds up, so that's something we've always been very proud of.
As things change and evolve, you know, styles kind of have merged. Yeah. And, you know, we were sort of on the cusp of that, you know, and I think forward thinking in that respect, and we always embraced technology, and so it became part of our sound. And don't stop, sure shot,
go out to the parking lot. Do you feel like you've copped sexism or even ageism throughout your career?
Well, it threatens everyone, you know, it really does. So,
well, I remember it was such a big deal when it was revealed very early on that you were 30. And that was like, oh my God, do you know, because you can't trust anybody over 25 at that point. You know?
Right. So, I don't know, you know, I mean, it's something about, you know, rock and roll having come of age as well, you know, and I'm sort of have definitely come along with it.
Debbie Harry and Chris Stein, thanks so much for chatting to us at 7:30.